High Point University presents A Conversation with Vincent Price and Nito Cabane is a production of UNC-TV in association with High Point University.
Hello, I'm Nito Cabane, president of High Point University, and we welcome you to this program. We have a very special guest today, the president of Duke University. A man whose life has been filled with distinction, a man who has achieved high honor in higher education and beyond. We welcome him to this campus today because we want to learn from him, and we want to collaborate with him as we all move forward in educating adults and young people in America and in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, the president of Duke University, Dr. Vincent Price. Welcome to High Point University.
Thank you.
So when I told people that Vincent Price is coming to High Point University, they said, we thought he's dead.
Yes. Yes, I grew up with this name, and as a child, I became accustomed to showing up and having people surprised. First, because I was so young, and later because they knew Vincent Price was dead.
Yes.
But I'm number 6 out of 8 children in my family, and I often wondered why my parents were possessed to name me Vincent Price. And I went to my mother at one point, and I said, Mom, so what's with the Vincent Price thing? And she looked at me very sincerely, and she said, your father and I just always loved that name. It's a beautiful name. We always loved it. And I walked away very happy until I stopped and reflect on the fact that I have an older brother, Steve, Mike, and Dave. They could have used a pretty common name. If they love Vincent so much, Steve might have been Vincent,
yes.
Right?
Yes, or Bob.
Or Bob,
Bob,
right?
Or Bill,
right.
Yes.
Yes. But nowadays, it's rarer for the students to know about Vincent,
yeah,
Price.
Yes. It's a piece of history, isn't it?
It is indeed.
Yeah. What surprised you the most when you became president of Duke University?
Well, I was provost at the University of Pennsylvania for 8 years. I felt very well prepared for most of what I've seen as president. Coming to Duke, I was struck by a number of things. Number one, the enthusiasm of our alumni community for Duke University is extraordinary. Mm. When you walk around the campus, and I believe it's the same here at High Point, you see so much apparel, just a visible display of pride. Basketball probably has something to do with this. Our proximity to the University of North Carolina. But that sense of enthusiasm for the whole proposition, it struck me palpably when I arrived. I also wasn't prepared for Durham. Durham is a city that over the last 10 years has really become transformed in a lot of ways, and is a vital part of the triangle, a diversity. Like every city, has its challenges, but is an extraordinary inflection point in its history. And so as a new community, Annette and I were thrilled to come to North Carolina.
And Duke University has played a major role in the evolution of the city of Durham in many, many ways. Economic impact, certainly geographic locales that have been improved and evolved and so on. So you were excited to come to Duke.
Mm-hmm.
Until you found out that Coach K makes significantly more than you make?
I knew this was the case.
Oh, you didn't know?
Yeah, I knew this was the case.
And you still came hoping that
it still
they
came.
Will...
No, it's been... Duke basketball has amplified the Duke brand in powerful ways. And of course, we live in a basketball region. To have UNC right down the road, NC State right down the road, NCCU, and we you know, Wake, we're... High Point. We're in a fabulous state that's committed to higher education, and the fervor for athletics is in my view, a tremendous benefit, and gives us international exposure because the fan base for basketball, collegiate basketball, is not just national in scope, it's international.
Whether that was an explanation or rationalization, you're eloquent. And Coach K has done a great job for you. There's no question about that.
Extraordinary leader.
You're the 10th president of Duke. You were born in Los Angeles. You're one of 8. You and Annette have 2 children. You met at a New Year's Eve party?
We did.
Who started the conversation with whom?
Good question. So this was actually a Serbian New Year's party.
A Serbian
New Year's party, celebrating Serbian New Year's, because we were undergraduates at Santa Clara University near San Jose, California, a Jesuit school. We loved our time there. And we had student colleagues who came out of the Central Valley of California. They were Serbian, and they hosted this party. I believe I introduced myself to her. It was fascinating.
Did she respond warmly, enthusiastically, or?
Well, it was fascinating because my roommate at the time spent most of his time talking with her. We didn't have all that many opportunities. And toward the end of the evening, I could tell that she was perhaps even relieved to break away and spend a little time with me.
Was he still your roommate after she was relieved?
Absolutely, absolutely. Wonderful, wonderful guy. Yes. And I have him to thank in many respects for our relationship, yes.
That's wonderful. And you worked at McDonald's, for heaven's sakes, and you showed up at 2 o'clock in the morning and did what?
Well, I started working at a McDonald's. My older brothers had worked there. It was the first job I had. Shortly after I started, the gentleman who was the custodian, essentially, for that facility, retired. And in a scramble to find somebody, they came to me and asked if I would want to do this. And I said, sure, it was summertime. And so it involved riding my bicycle at 2 o'clock in the morning to this McDonald's and, you know, cleaning up and emptying grease troughs and so on and waiting for the morning crew to come in. And I had an 8-hour shift. But for a kid in the summertime in California, it was a great gig because I was let out of work 11 o'clock or so, and I had the afternoon in front of me.
Wow.
But it was my first job.
You went on to become a political scientist. You chaired the Department of Communication, University of Michigan. For 11 years?
I didn't chair the department. I was at Michigan for 11 years, chaired the department for the last 3 or so. Mm-hmm.
And your master's is in communication from Stanford,
yes.
Is that right?
As well as my PhD in communication research.
And then you became the provost at the University of Pennsylvania. What a job that must have been.
It was a wonderful job, wonderful university. I've enjoyed every university I've been a part of. In truth, I've enjoyed being a student my entire life. But my arrival at Penn was interesting because I had been chair of a Department of Communication Studies at Michigan, became a faculty member of the Annenberg School for Communication at Penn, actually a smaller faculty than the department I chaired back at Michigan, but a fabulous faculty. And when I became provost, it was absolutely astounding to me that I became provost, number one, but that I was holding a job. I was the 29th provost of the University of Pennsylvania. The first provost was personally recruited by Benjamin Franklin to that institution. So I felt thrilled. And the interesting thing is that it didn't go well for the first provost. He turned out to be a Tory. Franklin became a revolutionary, as is well known. They were bitter enemies. The provost engineered the ouster of Benjamin Franklin as chair of the board of the institution. The Commonwealth legislature imprisoned the provost. He actually taught courses from jail. So I used to tell people that if I can stay out of jail, I will best the first provost of the University of Pennsylvania.
True, very
yes.
True. That must have been a very complex job, though.
Complex, indeed, because there are 12 schools at the University of Pennsylvania, 4 health schools, medicine, nursing, dental medicine, and veterinary medicine. Athletics reports to the provost there. Essentially all of the activities of the university, other than the expressly business activities, reported up to the provost. And so it gave me an appreciation for just how fantastic from top to bottom the organization was, but also just how incredibly complex the organization was. And one of the deans, Eduardo Glant, who was the dean of engineering there for many years, he said to me at one point, you know, when you step into an administrative role after having been a faculty member, it's as though someone draws a curtain and you see suddenly behind that curtain all of the machinery that makes a university work, all the staff members who support a university, all of the extraordinary work that supports the educational research enterprise. That's how I felt as provost. I felt this palpably.
Yeah. I very often speak at our faculty meetings, and I try to be very, very informational in my presentations, sharing ideas and information that typically are not stuff that most faculty would be necessarily focused on, but just to understand the university is truly a big machine. And the underlying mechanisms of this machine can make it or break it any day of the week. And for faculty members to do their job well, we need everybody else doing their job well. And there are many, many pieces to this puzzle. In your inaugural address at Duke University, you said, and I quote, "Today's workforce, today's human needs, today's students, all have been transformed by the digital age." We certainly agree with you on that. The question is, how do you see that transformation? Positive, negative, impact, influence, useful, useless?
Right. Well, it is transformative in so many ways. It has changed markets around the world. It is, in part, responsible for and a product of the globalization of markets worldwide. It's hard to find a part of the world that is insulated from trends that are happening on the other side of the globe. Because of these technologies, they've accelerated commerce, communication, contact between peoples. Those are beneficial things, but they put tremendous strain on society. They disrupt workforces and workplaces and markets. And so I think for higher education, the impact is quite significant. I think it requires us to reflect on the enduring value of a liberal arts education in new ways, because you can't think of our mission as a mission of training people for a job that will last them all that long. They need to be prepared to adapt to changing workplaces, regardless of their profession. And so building out a set of skills that will last them over a lifetime becomes that much more important.
Let me see if it's in this book or was it, I want to tell you about that. Let me see here, because you just said liberal arts. We're living in a time in higher education where so many people are questioning value, so many people are questioning applied value post-graduation. Here is the Chronicle of Higher Education. Says kids want to get jobs, and the whole article is about that value is related directly to getting jobs at the end. We all proudly say that at High Point within 6 months 97% of our students get a job or go to graduate school of their choice. Ad nauseum, you and I and all of us in higher education have been saying stories about enrollment shortfalls spread to more private colleges, and people are worried about colleges that are merging and purging and closing, and even if open have, if open for business, still having a lot of challenges, fiscal challenges certainly, and other challenges as well. And so, like you, I like to read a lot. I've read about 15 books this summer alone about higher education. This is a brand new book called Cracks in the Ivory Tower, and it's written by two academics. It says, "The Moral Mess of Higher Education," which is a rather disturbing book, really. Yes. But in it, they talk about a lot of issues, and one of them says, "General ed, generally, general eds, plural, generally, don't work." And then they attack higher education this way. "Faculty exploit students by forcing them to take useless and ineffective courses that students don't want to." I'm not sure that students always know what they need, so there's a difference between want and need here. "There are lots of things I did not want to study when I was in college." "The purpose of many gen eds is to transfer money from students to professors." That is a terrible statement to be made by academics. I'm a product of liberal arts. I know a lot of leaders of major corporations in this country who majored in liberal arts. certainly at least at the undergraduate level. You just spoke positively about liberal arts and gen eds. Mm-hmm. What is it that you would say to, I think these are guys, to these two guys?
Right.
Well, general education is one matter. Let me talk about the liberal arts. The liberal arts, as traditionally conceived, were what? They were the sets of skills required of free people in civil society. And the question in my mind is, what are the liberal arts for the 21st century? Probably not the quadrivium and trivium, right? But the set of enduring skills that are professional skills. There is no, I think universities have made a tremendous error in contrasting professional education and preparation with a liberal arts education. There is no way in which, if done properly, the liberal arts aren't a consummate preparation for professional life. Mm-hmm. I think that students are looking for jobs, there's no question. Mm-hmm. The cost of higher education today, parents, students alike, have every reason to want to see this as an investment with a return, mm-hmm. and that translates essentially into a job. But as I said before, the long game professionally requires a foundational set of skills. That's what the liberal arts are about. Now, general education is a different thing entirely, in my view. We have lived on a model of higher education now for around a century that was well adapted to scaling up after World War II. As you had students flock to higher education on GI Bill support, for example. And it was cookie cutter, designed to be this way. Large courses, standardized curricula, transferable credits, a great system, the best in the world, the absolute best in the world. Is that the system that will carry us the next 100 years? I doubt it very much. I doubt it very much. But it's a moment for universities, if faculties take this seriously, and we are at Duke, we're thinking about these issues, and I'm sure at High Point you are as well. How do you leverage the fact that we are a research university? How do we take students who want to learn, develop, discover from day one, start them exploring, especially in teams, use problem solving as the lever to open the mind, mm-hmm. and then the students will decide what they need, not just want, but need, mm-hmm. by way of backfill. Mm-hmm. So as opposed to slogging through 2 years of required courses to get to the good stuff, mm-hmm. you start with the good stuff. And you put students in positions where they realize, oh my gosh, to do what I want to do, I need to learn French, mm-hmm. or Chinese. To do what I want to do, I need to learn chemistry. I need to learn computer science. Mm-hmm. And then they go out and they collect those skills and abilities. This is the better way to learn. It's motivated learning. It's also grounded in the research enterprise, which is playing to a strength of higher education. So we're living with systems that have been so valuable to us, but we have to adapt institutionally. Mm-hmm. I'm convinced this will not sacrifice the liberal arts if we do it right. It will re-engage the liberal arts. Computing today, in my mind, would qualify as a liberal art. It is one of the skills that people have to understand to be a free citizen in civil society today. Not to program, not to be a software engineer, but to understand the impact on their lives. Yeah. Artificial intelligence, machine learning.
It's a prerequisite.
Absolutely. So I'm excited by this. I don't see this as a problem. I think the defensive posture of higher education, you know, liberal arts colleges are struggling economically. But this is not a time for retrenchment. It's a time to embrace those challenges and move forward, but to do it in a way that honors the values that have driven the enterprise for centuries.
You'd be very pleased to know that at High Point, we work on these issues all the time. Our faculty are both nimble and flexible and certainly very learned and smart about what is and what has to become. And we say...
They take yoga. It helps with being nimble and flexible.
Yes, it does. and we say at High Point that, you know, we got to prepare students for the world as it is going to be, yes. Not as it is, not as it was. Learn from the past, of course, and appreciate the present, but you better be prepared for a world that's as Tom Friedman told us almost a dozen years ago, the world is flat, and man, has he been right about that. So All this sounds great, but how do you execute on that in a large, complicated, advanced, mature university like Duke? Respected clearly across the world, resourced amply, at least, you know, from an outsider's point of view. How does a dedicated leader like you come in and truly, truly create transformative change?
By posing the right questions and challenges to the community, and by leveraging what's already being done. So at a place like Duke, we now have 45,000 students applying for the first year class. We have a fabulous residential educational program. It's the best it's ever been in the history of our university. And I would say it's among the very best a student can acquire in the world today. There's nothing broken at all about it. But the question is, how do you innovate and change and adapt and not mistake where you are today for where you need to go? And the same way, when you're admitting a student, how do you avoid confusing where a student sits with the trajectory they're on? Because if you're obsessed with you know, sort of relative standing among peers, you miss the fact that what you really ought to be looking at are the trajectories that brought them there. Because the smart move would be on someone, you know, admitting someone who's maybe not in absolute terms the most competitive applicant, but you look at the trajectory, you say, wow, their future. Mm-hmm. is extraordinarily bright. So how do you do that as a community and a complex institution, as you say? I think you start with experimental programs, and we've done this at Duke. Our faculty have developed fabulous programs. Team-based experiential learning, problem-based learning is everywhere at Duke right now. The engineering school just restructured their first year program, so it's built around design from day one. It has been transformative for that curriculum. The students are in what we call BAS Connections programs. They're theme-based programs that attack a theme in a very interdisciplinary fashion. And they pull together students, faculty, and staff from around the university, multiple disciplines, but also vertically integrated. So you have faculty, postdoctoral students, graduate students, undergraduates together on team projects. So that's the future. We haven't quite baked that into the formal curriculum quite yet, but I leave it to the faculty to figure that out. That's why we have deans, that's why we have faculties. I'm confident we'll get there. My job is to be a nudge, right, to bother people, to make sure they're not feeling complacent. That's when you have the levels of success we've enjoyed, mm-hmm. your enemy is complacency. Mm-hmm. I don't see a lot of that at Duke, and I'm not worried.
And Dr. Price, I hope you never forget that all of Duke University started right here in our neighborhood.
That's right.
Right here down the road at Trinity. That's where it all started. So you guys owe us a lot.
We owe North Carolina a lot. We owe so many people.
No, I'm not talking about North Carolina. I'm talking about High Point.
High Point. Right here. Sure. Well, so in Randolph County, what is now Trinity.
How about 10% of your endowment coming this way?
Sure, yes. I'll check in with my trustees and get back to you.
No doubt you're familiar with a guy called Jim Collins who wrote Good to Great and all the rest of it. He's a very clever guy. He sends these books out. So he sent me an autographed copy of the book, me and 2 million other people on in his database. But as you know, he wrote some really pretty good books, and a lot of America's industry and nonprofits follow what he says. This is a little quote from this book. He says, those who lead organizations from good to great first get the right people on the bus. That's a metaphor he used in all of his books. And the wrong people off the bus. And then figure out where to drive the bus. You, Dr. Price, at Duke University, how do you get the wrong people off the bus?
Well, I think it's accomplished in multiple ways. One way is, again, through challenging people, giving everybody an opportunity to get on that bus is critical. I don't think good leaders make quick judgments about this. It takes time to understand strengths in any person associated with an organization like a university. But when you've agreed that you want to move the institution in a particular direction, then it's a choice people make. They can decide to get on or off the bus. It's not a matter of tossing them off. It's a matter of just making clear, this is where we're headed, and if you want to be on this team, you're with us. If not, you can do other things, but this is where the institution is going. It takes time to do that. Mm. Now, we have the luxury of time, given the resources we have and a variety of other factors. There are times in an organization where decisions have to be made and people have to be essentially let go. Mm. I think any good leader has to know three things. They have to know their cause. Leadership for what, right? And you can assert the cause, or you can, in my view, more powerful position is to help that institution identify its cause collectively. It takes a little time to do that, but that's the first step. Know the cause, know where the bus is headed. Secondly, know your culture. And as you well know, the academy has all kinds of cultural norms, and it's different from campus to campus. Every university I've been a part of, different culture. You have to understand that culture. You have to honor that culture. You can't come in and sweep it aside to be an effective leader. And thirdly, you have to know your character. And you have to know well enough where you have strengths and where you have perhaps deficits or weaknesses, and then complement those weaknesses with other strong people. If people see a leader doing that, the vast majority will want to get on board. That's my view. And you know, if they miss the bus stop, they'll see a lot of happy people on the bus waving at them as the bus pulls away.
Mm-hmm. So what when you add people to your circle of influence, your leadership circle, what are the two or three characteristics you look for?
Collaboration, number one, without question. Universities become so quickly siloed. Disciplines, departments, they are products of an attempt to map human knowledge that's defective. It's just a map, but it's confused with reality. And so people have to be flexible of mind, but especially flexible in how they work with other people. So collaboration is absolutely number one. Secondly is they do need to be delegators if they're high level leaders. There's an impulse for people to take things on and do things themselves, and it quickly runs out of steam. People are prone to micromanagement, all kinds of challenges. Mm-hmm. To keep your head above water takes a lot of energy. You can't be doing everything. You need to be able to delegate. And then the third would be honesty. Mm-hmm.
Character.
I need people, if people see something that's not right, either that something they disagree with or they think that something is happening that's wrong, they need to say something. Mm-hmm. That takes guts mm-hmm. in any organization. And so people have to be honest. And I like to tell people on my leadership team, I don't want to be that person who has a wonderful dinner, everyone's laughing, fabulous time. I arrive home, look in the mirror, and I've got this big piece of lettuce stuck to my cheek. Mm. And I think, why didn't anybody mm-hmm. say something?
Yeah.
You have to have teammates mm-hmm. who have the guts, really. And you have to show them, you have to reward them for that behavior, especially when you don't want to hear it. You have to get over that initial reaction, which is, are you kidding me? To step back and say, thank you.
Yes.
Because you encourage them to do it. Mm-hmm. But those are the three things, sure. in my view. Collaboration, an ability to delegate, and honesty.
Yeah. And you talked about the cause of an organization. And in your framework at Duke, and this is precisely your document, but I'll share it here with our viewers. You said, as we turn our attention to the future, and I assume you're the architect of all of this, I believe you are, our community must answer two interconnected questions. What do we want Duke to look like 10 years from now or 100 years from now? And what steps will we need to take to get us there? President Price has developed a strategic framework that seeks to answer these questions, a framework focused on five core areas. And here are the five areas: empowering people, transforming education, building community, forging partnerships, and engaging our network. And I added to that, and on the sixth and seventh days he shall rest. This is an enormously demanding and all-encompassing large goals.
Right.
How are you going to do all this?
I'm not going to do all this. I like to tell people my job is one that involves doing nothing. And I say this only somewhat facetiously. Delegation. We spent a year, the Board of Trustees, faculty leaders, and others, thinking about that framework. It is broad, but it gives us a way collectively to talk about where we're headed. And nested within each of those five planks of that framework are strategic plans that I've reviewed of the schools. And in some sense, this is designed to subsume those plans, which are not mine. They've been articulated by the individual schools of the university, the provost, the chancellor for health affairs. But this gives us a way to tell a bigger story about our ambitions so that every member of that community feels they're part of the project. This is critical. You mentioned Trinity College. Trinity College started in Randolph County, a one-room schoolhouse, moved to Durham in the early 90s, became Duke University in the mid-20s. And that transition from Trinity College to Duke University happened in 1924. Mm-hmm. With the year
this school was founded, by the way.
That's
1924.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
So we will be...
We could be Duke today if you didn't screw up.
No, but we will be celebrating centenaries together. And so I think it's a reflection on a century of progress. And I'm very proud of it's hard to point to a university that's made the kind of progress Duke University has made in 100 years. From a solid, strong liberal arts institution in the South, but a struggling one, to the Duke University of today in 100 years. That's an enormous trajectory. But a centenary is an opportunity to think about, what about the next 100 years? And I would be doing the university less than my best if I didn't stake out very ambitious goals.
And stretch it, and stretch the goals
right.
and the viewpoints of it all.
Right.
Well, we certainly think highly of Duke University. At HPU University, number one, we're both connected to the United Methodist Church. Number two, we try to hire as many Duke graduates as possible. We have a number of them here. Occasionally, we steal one of your professors, and we've got several of your faculty members who've come here and have done amazing things for us, and we're very grateful for all of that. I saw an interview that you did with the dean of your law school.
So this was the right Vincent Price, because the other Vincent Price also did interviews. It's good.
Oh, but they killed him. Let me see, in a conversation, TV conversation you had with your law school dean, you said that residential universities truly are important. Now, we are a residential university at HPU University. In fact, 94% of our students live on campus, which is very good. Mm-hmm. It creates, you know, a much more collaborative environment, teamwork, fellowship, et cetera, and therefore personal and professional growth. It also is very demanding on us fiscally because that means that capital expenses have to be available in ample supply to build the residential facilities and provide food and additional auxiliary services that are necessary. What was running in your head when you said that a residential university is important? And I say that because so many universities today are promoting online, for example, learning. It's one thing to promote it for adults, meaning people who have been engaged in business and nonprofits and other areas, and they want to go back and get a degree, and they can't therefore leave their place of work. But a lot of it now is also promoting, you know, your high school graduates who could do that. What were you thinking when you said that?
Well, a couple of things. One is that if I'm correct in thinking that the 21st century is going to demand collaborative employees, people who are able to work in teams effectively, develop the kinds of leadership skills that get great things done, it's hard to imagine that they can do that in a social vacuum. You have to create not just an intellectual community, mm-hmm. schools of thought, but physical communities of people. Mm-hmm. This is how people learn so much about
an engaging physical
absolutely,
community.
Absolutely, to be a citizen of the university, to be a student leader, to understand through direct interaction with others just how challenging it can be, to encounter people who disagree, to encounter people who are so unlike you in terms of your background, your origin, to be put back on your heels, to feel from time to time as a stranger in a very strange land. These are the experiences that make mm-hmm. great people, great minds. So
and to live with a roommate who was really after your wife.
Initially.
Until you emerged with your persuasive powers.
There you go. Yes. There you go. No, all those things. I also think that there is a lot about, we know from brain science about the kinds of developmental leaps that are being made in those ages, the traditional college going age, you know, 17, 18 to the mm-hmm. early 20s. And I think it puts a premium on those kinds of residential experiences. Now, I do think that it there's no question it's a very expensive proposition and getting more expensive by the day. Mm-hmm. And the challenge is how you can make that widely available. Mm-hmm. Maybe we could be hybridizing the curriculum and doing, I think we are spending time doing things didactically that could be better supported through different kinds of technological platforms. But it's not that you would trade what's happening now for that. It's that we think more intelligently about how we deploy those technologies to do a better job. I also think that if we're serious about lifelong learning, that you build around that residential experience a virtualized continuing education that every graduate leans on for the rest of their lives.
Beyond undergraduate.
Absolutely.
Right.
It's not an either-or proposition. Yeah. I think those who set online education against mm-hmm. residential educational experiences are just thinking about things the wrong way.
Yeah. But you see, Vince, you read a lot of stuff about higher education that does not come from a position of true knowledge. For example, I read a lot of stuff that says, and I read it in journals, higher education journals, will say, well, such and such an institution has X number of faculty and X multiplied by two numbers of non-faculty. Well, how in the world are you going to do a residential facility, for example, and not have a ton of staff? If you just think of food service alone at HPU University, we have something like 400 employees in food service. If you think about a residential facility, that means you have to have a security group. That means you have to have a transportation group. That means you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So a lot of what I read, and not just in this area, but in every, even fiscal areas. I come from a background of finance and marketing and so on. So I'm very interested in those issues. And I read such incomplete information, if not at times immature deliberation right. of discussion about issues that suggest to me the person who wrote this has never run anything. Because if they've administered anything, they would know better than to make statements of A, B, or C. Let's take an important subject to you, for sure, because Duke has handled this subject miraculously well. But it's true of all of us. Affordability. The number one reason why students do not come to High Point University is affordability, right? They just can't afford the fees and so on that we request. We are not privileged with an endowment that can say, as you say, once you're admitted, don't worry about the rest of it. We will help you in every way to make it happen. Someday we hope to get there. But in the interim, trying to make a school like High Point, residential school, private school, resourced, may I dare say, as well as some of the finest universities in America. If you look at our state-of-the-art learning environments, if you look at our faculty, if you look at our where they live, where they study, where they collaborate, it's remarkable what we have. But to make all that happen, you have to charge for it.
Right.
Or you have to have significant fundraising that offset that. So what is your solution for mid-size institutions? I'm not suggesting that's been your lifelong research or anything like that, but just an opinion of a significantly experienced leader in higher education. What is the solution as you see it for mid-size institutions, some of whom are in North Carolina, right? You and I are members of NCICU, I see you there. There's a lot of struggling going on, and I don't see, Vince, I don't see the solution around the corner. I see more trouble coming around the corner in significant supply. And I hear presidents say to me, I don't know how to do this. So what they do is they end up cutting, number of faculty, number of programs. And all that is a race to, the end of the world. But I'm sure you've thought about this. I know you talk to people about it. What is your view of that?
So a couple of things. One is the struggle for resources is intense, and being articulate about the value proposition to generate those resources, largely philanthropically, sometimes through different forms of state support, depending on the nature of the institution, and getting out of that defensive posture. Higher education, I'd say collectively,
we will say that one more time. Get out of
that defensive posture. Because higher education, we've allowed ourselves collectively to be positioned, oddly enough, almost as a problem,
mm-hmm.
which for those in the educational enterprise is a shocking way to be considered.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be number one. Number two would be, so not to give up on resources, but to make the case, because that case has never been more important to make than
mm-hmm.
now. And this is a national challenge.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we can talk about isolated institutions that are struggling, but higher education is struggling in the United States. Public institutions, private institutions, the best resourced, and Duke is among them, can feel a bit insulated, but it is no more immune to these forces than any other institution. What made us as a nation so compelling worldwide was our willingness to invest in education and higher education in particular, especially after World War II, as I mentioned. So that's, we just have to be better and more articulate. But the other thing is to be seriously creative. I think that the death spiral that you described
mm-hmm.
is a very real phenomenon. And at some point, one has to say, this model, the whole model, is broken for us. And we need to alter that model programmatically. So maybe we should hybridize what we're doing. Maybe we retain our educational residential character, but we couple that with online experiences that allow students to have that kind of both-and proposition in a certain formula that is unique and that identifies a market for students who are attracted at a price point that they can then afford. But that takes real work to do. It takes real courage to do.
Mm-hmm. And it takes a complete shift in mindset.
It does. But let's face it, existential threats to an institution can be powerful. And my hope is that people are not fatalistic in the way they respond to those threats, but they see on the other side of those threats an opportunity. That's the only way forward. And that kind of leadership often does come from institutions that find themselves with their backs to the wall and see that exit that other people haven't seen and take it. And we'll take a couple of powerful examples and we'll see things happen as a result. We have to do this. We have to do this. But it takes courage, not just courage from educational leaders. It takes courage from political leaders to stop beating up on universities. It takes courage to think about investing in collective welfare. And I'm not talking just about universities. I'm talking about infrastructure and communities around the country. Our willingness to invest for future generations has been our greatest strength, and it's dissipating rapidly. In my lifetime, I never thought I would see higher education kicked around the way it's kicked around. Mm-hmm. You know, and if you look at confidence in institutions,
it's not just government. I mean, the media.
The public as well. If you look at the trajectory of survey data that assess confidence in institutions, mm-hmm. The trajectory. You know, the media lost public confidence in the 70s. Mm-hmm. Congress. The Supreme Court, which maintained very high levels of support, both politicized in terms of support and declining. Mm-hmm. Higher education now, which for years did very well. Even small business. The institution that's so far been unaffected, in fact, has seen growth in confidence, is the military. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure what that says about our society right now. Mm-hmm. But that confidence in public institutions, and by public I mean institutions that are dedicated to the public welfare through education, through, you know, generating economic development, that has to be resuscitated somehow. Higher education can be a major player there.
Yeah. I agree with you. But I also think that we have, in higher education, brought some of that upon ourselves.
Without question.
And we have got to come out of it somehow. Because I think we have not done a good job in, we render value, but that's not where the essence lies. The essence lies in interpreting the value in a way that other people who are not engaged in the inner circle understand what you're talking about.
Agreed.
And identify with it. After all, the most important law in all of communication is the law of identification. When something becomes personal, it becomes important. We have to show people that higher education is very personal. It's the future of our country. It's the way we're going to compete with BRICS, you know, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, countries in between and countries beyond.
And I would add to that, we've done ourselves no service by expressing our ambition in ways that are completely deaf to the concerns of surrounding communities, right? So institutions like Duke and others are proud of our global stature, our global ambitions, but that rings hollow if 20 miles from our campus you have communities that are economically struggling and they don't feel the impact of that institution, and the institution doesn't seem to be expressing not a case, but even the desire to be of service. Mm-hmm. That has to change. Mm-hmm. You know, that we have to be for all here in North Carolina, for all of North Carolina, not just the urban areas, not just the areas that become sort of innovation hotspots, but all of North Carolina. And there's a tremendous opportunity. We already are in many respects that are under recognized. We have to tell those stories more compellingly, but we have to articulate to our own communities just how important that is to us, and to not just to our survival as institutions, but to our founding missions.
Yes, and not just talk about it, but be actionists and make something happen. Vince, I'm very proud of High Point University in exactly that way. We recognize that we are, may I use the word, affluent institution in the midst of much socioeconomic challenges. And this institution rises to the occasion, and not just in simple ways, like economic impact that the university can create in a community, for example, that's obvious, but more so in service learning. You know, we have a 7 or 8 vistas that we endow every year to serve in the community. We have a service learning program that's as good as they come. Our faculty voted, for example, to go to the assistance of Bennett College because we believed in the cause of it all. Faculty and staff and board of trustees of HPU University committed very serious resources to the development of downtown High Point. We acknowledge that town and gown must be partners. We learned from you too. We did some research on Duke and what you have done in the city of Durham and then beyond, and RTP. In fact, you're involved. You're on the board at RTP. Yeah. So we encourage our faculty and staff to be on boards, and not just to give money. We're good at that, but to get engaged with, to be brain trust and leaders and volunteers.
And also listeners.
And listeners.
Listeners, because I think, again, if an institution, any anchor institution in a community, confuses leadership with, you know, their ability to identify the problems and attack them, they'll founder. We are problem-solving communities. That's what we do. We build the resources on the faculty, the students, the staff to solve problems. We're not always the best at identifying the right problems. When we go out to our communities, we should be hearing about their problems and then bring that back and ask about how we can marshal our core missions, do what we do best, research, education, to help, to become partners. That's why the fourth plank and those planks that you yes. read, those forming stronger regional partnerships. Yes. The word partnership is intentional. And this is not about an institution doing anybody else favors. It's about an institution working with partners for the common good because mm-hmm. it elevates the whole community, including the institution. It's in everyone's interest to do that. Mm-hmm. But it requires being able to listen much mm-hmm. more effectively.
So you are a fascinating person to talk to for a long time, certainly about higher education, but about the world in general, where we're headed as a society and where our responsibilities are. I admire you for your work and cheer you on as you continue to do great work now at Duke University. 10 years from now, when you look back at your tenure at Duke, or 15, or 7, or whenever you choose to move on to other things, when you look back at your work at Duke, what would cause you to say, that was a really meaningful chapter of my life, I'm proud of that? What would that be?
Well, it would be if I could confidently say to myself that I stepped in and as a sounding board for the community, and I know you've spoken about and written about service leadership. If I could feel that the community at Duke University sees this period of time, this critical decade in the 21st century, to celebrate how far they had come, and then map out a path forward that puts us out there as a leader in having redefined undergraduate residential education, is the campus that people think of readily when they think about a campus that's gotten it right in terms of working with communities. And I think more than anything else, as a campus that reclaimed this notion in a deep way that when you become a part of this intellectual community, this university, you are with us for life. And our faculty are actively engaged in the life of our students and vice versa, that our alumni in some ways are functioning like adjunct faculty, that they have a much larger role to play in career planning and active decision making, that nodes of Dukies around the globe are supporting each other, and that other universities look at Duke and say, that was the model, that's the 21st century version of higher education. That's what I'd like to be. Not so much for me, but for Duke University. And if I can confidently say, you know, I was of assistance to my colleagues in getting us there, I will be the happiest person on the planet. Now, that being said, I'm already the happiest person on the planet. I love what I do. To have the really luxury of going to all those dinners and spending all this time and going to basketball and football and lacrosse and soccer and softball games, it's fantastic. I'm loving it. So my hope is that I can keep doing this long enough through the centenary and beyond, the community has a very strong sense of purpose.
Well, my prayer is that you will do all of that and more, and I faithfully believe that you will be able to do it.
Well, you've done it here.
Well,
let's face it,
you've done it here.
High Point is doing extraordinary things, and we're in this together. So I will be looking to you for answers. I'll send you emails late at night.
Yeah. I will answer them between 8 and 5 the next day. Ladies and gentlemen, President Vincent Price.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
You did a great job.
Thank you.
Great job.
Quality public television is made possible through the financial contributions of viewers like you, who invite you to join them in supporting UNC TV.